I'm Anjan. My pronouns are he, him, his. And I live in a part of Coral Gables, Florida, that was built on land belonging to the Seminole and Tequesta peoples, or as we say in Canada, the Seminole and Tequesta First Nations. I'm genuinely honored to be part of this excellent conference with a lovely name, Distant But Together. And I'd really like to thank Nicole, Meredith, Emily, and the rest of the gang at the AHA for the very hard work of organizing such a stimulating event, and of course, including me in it. Today, I'm going to be talking a little about the nature of scientific consensus and disagreement. Let me start with an easy question. Why should humanists care about science? That's so easy as to be rhetorical, because we all know that you do, and why. But if you ever need a refresher, have a look at the AHA's 10 commitments, their guiding principles for teaching values in schools, which we'll hear about later from Kristen and Jennifer. Among the things that humanists value that are nicely described there, we find commitments to gaining knowledge in reliable ways and descriptions of techniques for doing this that are integral to the sciences. We also find a commitment to a sensible caution when it comes to believing things in the absence of the sorts of evidence that these techniques reveal and collect. So let me just add one thing of my own here. When you look through the list at the various other things that humanists care deeply about, like taking care of each other and the planet, bringing about various goals of social justice and so on, it's immediately obvious that in order to do these things, we need to act. And in order to act, we need reliable information. So humanists care about science not merely because they value its techniques of investigation as sources of genuine knowledge, but because this information can function as a tool, as an instrument for bringing about the many other things that humanists value. I'm going to come back to this idea of science as an instrument for bringing about the common good again toward the end. So keep that in the back of your mind, and I'll come back to it shortly. Okay, so we all understand why humanists care about science. That was the easy question. Let me turn to a harder question. Why should humanists care about scientific agreement and disagreement? Well, you might think that that's an easy question too, right? I mean, after all, the sciences comprise a huge number of highly specialist disciplines. The education and training and infrastructure that's required to perform all of these investigations is, of course, extremely involved and complex. In other words, these disciplines are inhabited by people with highly developed forms of expertise. Most people, as lay people, when they require information that only those with expertise can give, have no other option but to consult the experts. If you could just work it out for yourself, right? How much more likely, say, certain minority populations are to suffer from inequities in education or healthcare. Or if you could just work out for yourself how best to, say, harness the power of the sun or the wind to generate electricity, or, say, to treat a novel coronavirus, well, then you could just do it. But we can't. Answers to these questions require expertise in the very techniques of investigation that I alluded to a moment ago. So to obtain at least some forms of reliable information or knowledge, we rely on experts. So why should we care about scientific disagreement? The easy answer is that since, as lay people, we're in the position of having to rely on experts, and if experts disagree, that may seem to leave us in a bit of a bind, right? It's one thing if they all agree, but if they don't, well, then what? So in the rest of the time that I have today, I want to say a few things about how often, in scientific contexts, disagreement is actually more complicated than you might think it is. In some cases, it's actually a very good thing, even if it may require a bit of patience on our part to allow for it to evolve ultimately into a reliable consensus. In other cases, disagreement can actually be very long-lasting, right? And sometimes perhaps even incapable of being resolved. But in those cases, it turns out that disagreement about some things typically coexists with a consensus about the very parts of science that we actually need to act in the world. In other words, long-standing disagreement about some things is actually compatible with agreement about the reliable information we need to actually do things to bring about positive change in the world. So let me dig in here. And as just a reminder of what Nicole said, I'm going to try to leave a bit of time for questions. So if you have any, put them in the chat and we'll get to a few of them later. Okay. Before engaging with genuine scientific disagreement, I want to set aside something that sadly we encounter all the time in our less than perfect world, namely misleading appearances of scientific disagreement. In an ideal world, there wouldn't be anyone trying to mislead us into thinking that there's disagreement when in fact there really isn't. So for example, there's what I call pretend disagreement. So consider, for example, recent attempts to undermine a general consensus regarding anthropogenic contributions to climate change via disinformation. For instance, by, say, giving disproportionate emphasis to outlier opinions at the expense of what's generally held to be the case among experts. Sometimes scientific practice itself is subverted at the source. For example, in the well-documented case of how tobacco companies funded research this past century in order to bolster their claims, right, their false claims, that smoking or secondhand smoke really isn't harmful to human health. These kinds of efforts by nefarious actors, right, whether in the form of communicating skewed descriptions of scientific work or by skewing the work itself by tainting the process via funding effects, can create misleading impressions of what should, in fact, be recognized as genuine consensus. So in addition to pretend disagreement, there's also what we in the business called pseudoscience, right? Claims that are and theories that give the superficial impression of being scientific when in fact they're not scientific at all. They don't really subscribe to the techniques of investigation that we associate with the modern sciences. You've all encountered pseudoscience, right? Astrology, homeopathy, right, et cetera. Pseudoscience may give the mistaken impression that there's scientific disagreement, because if you compare what your homeopathist says to what your doctor says, you may get different advice. But of course, that isn't genuine scientific disagreement because pseudoscience isn't science. Now, I don't want to suggest for even a moment that pretend disagreement and impressions of disagreement created by pseudoscience aren't serious problems that we need to combat, right? They certainly are. But let me leave these misleading impressions of scientific disagreement to one side and now focus in on the genuine article. The American astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson, who's come up, said, this was on Twitter 3 years ago, he said, "Anyone who thinks scientists like agreeing with one another has never attended a scientific conference." What's interesting about this from my perspective is that disagreement here takes different forms. And depending on what sort of disagreement we're talking about, it makes sense to think about it differently. So for today, let me make a fairly coarse-grained distinction, right? I'm going to contrast what I call transient disagreement, which is typical of more unsettled science, with stable disagreement, which is typical of more settled science, right? So I'll say more about what it means to be settled and unsettled in a minute. So transient disagreement on the one hand versus stable disagreement on the other. So let's consider transient disagreement first. This is common, as I just mentioned, when the relevant science hasn't really settled down yet. Maybe it's at an early stage of development, or it's very cutting edge, or for whatever reason, it's still pretty speculative. In that sort of context, the science is unsettled because there are still a lot of basic disagreements between scientists to be sorted out, right? So for example, what direction should the research go in? What methods should we use to investigate? I call this transient disagreement because we generally expect it to be resolved. And far from being a bad thing, disagreement here is extremely important because it functions like an engine that drives us ultimately towards consensus. It forces us to explore a range of possibilities that helps us to make progress. A lot of my own work is about physics and biology. Right now in physics, researchers are trying hard to come up with a theory that unifies the four currently known fundamental forces of nature. So we have quantum theory, which describes things like electromagnetic forces. And we want to combine that somehow with relativity theory, which describes gravity. This theorizing in physics is cutting edge, it's highly speculative. Physicists themselves regard it as far from settled. There's heated debate, disagreement between them about conflicting approaches to it and what promise there is for success using one model or another. That's one example. Take an example that's much closer to home for most people today. It's very early days in our study of the novel coronavirus that causes the associated disease, COVID-19. Both the virus and the disease are, literally and figuratively, under a microscope right now. We began with no empirical evidence about these things, and over the past month, scientists have been massively scaling up their efforts to investigate them by acquiring more evidence, forming hypotheses, testing them, performing experiments, performing trials, and so on. This is a paradigm case of what I mean by unsettled science. We're trying our best, but we have a ways to go. So it's natural in these sorts of contexts that there will be disagreement about the sorts of things I mentioned a moment ago, right? Which directions the research should go, what methods we should use, which hypotheses are most promising, etc. But there's every expectation that these disagreements are transient, that they will lead to greater and greater consensus as the science settles. Okay, what about stable disagreement, which is typical of more settled science? Well, let me give you an example of that too. So earlier I mentioned quantum theory. That's our current best theory of how matter behaves and interacts at the level of the very small, right? So for example, atoms and subatomic particles. It was developed in a fascinating series of developments last century. And that, together with what's called the standard model of particle physics, which really coalesced in the 1970s, gives us an amazingly successful unified set of descriptions of the properties of various kinds of particles and how they interact with one another. It's truly a wonderful thing. It's also, in the way I described earlier, properly described as more settled science. It's not that it won't be further developed. It's not that it won't be incorporated in some form into an even better and more successful theory in due course. But the basic insights of the relevant physics are largely agreed upon, and scientists expect most or all of them to be preserved in some form going forward. In that sense, the science here is more settled. It isn't at an early stage of development or very speculative. Massive amounts of data support it. But all of that said, it's not as though there isn't room for disagreement here too. And that's what I call stable disagreement, because the science is more settled and relatively stable. Some of you will know all about this from popular accounts of the weirdness of quantum physics, right? It's really difficult to understand what the theory is telling us about some pretty fundamental questions regarding what these tiny constituents of matter are like. Are they really like particles in anything like the everyday sense of the word? Well, they behave that way in some contexts, but not always. So maybe it would be better to think of them not that way, but in terms of, say, fields, quantum fields, which are arguably very different sorts of things. There's room for disagreement about these sorts of foundational interpretational issues, even in contexts of more settled science. Okay, all of that was just to get across the idea that at different stages of inquiry, science can be more unsettled or it can be more settled. When it's more unsettled, there's usually a lot of disagreement, but we can expect a lot of it to be transient, to lead ultimately to consensus. When it's more settled, there's a lot of consensus, but that's compatible with some stable disagreement about parts of it. So let me return now, finally, to the question that I started out with. We rely on the experts, we rely on scientists for reliable information, for knowledge. Most of us don't have that expertise ourselves. So what do we do when they disagree? I think the answer to that question really depends on whether we're talking about transient disagreement or stable disagreement. So let me take those two types of disagreement in turn. First, transient disagreement. The first thing we have to do is recognize that most of the things that are important to us, right, that are most pressing, that are most impactful on our lives, are complicated, right? It takes time to investigate them carefully and systematically so that the results of these investigations are well supported and reliable. In the meantime, if it's especially pressing or life-threatening, like COVID-19, we may have to rely on the interim best judgment of scientific experts, knowing that this may be revised, probably will be revised, as we acquire more and more evidence and their best judgments become better and better supported. We have to understand that just like the rest of us, experts can only do the best with what they've got. But their best is always going to be a better bet than non-expert judgment. So even if we can expect scientific judgment to change as it improves, as we undergo the transition from unsettled to more settled science, it's always our best bet. Now, you'd think this would be obvious. Of course, it's obvious to all of you. But we see in the news every day, right, how the fact that scientists have been updating their best judgments about how best to avoid novel coronavirus infection and treat COVID-19 has been used, right, for obvious and repellent political reasons to attempt to discredit scientific work. To fall for this is just to misunderstand the nature of unsettled science. Sure, there's going to be plenty of disagreement. In this domain, that's a necessary precursor to consensus. But even in unsettled science, if there's a preponderance of consensus at any given time, that's your best bet, right? So if the preponderance of consensus is to wear a mask, but an outlier who thinks that certain gynecological conditions are caused by having sex with witches and demons and dreams, so there's no reason to wear a mask, well, you know, you probably know what to do. What about the case of more settled science? Well, here, owing to the fact that the science itself is more stable, disagreements about how to interpret certain foundational issues also tend to be quite stable. And this may feel understandably worrying to non-experts because it suggests that on these issues, perhaps we shouldn't expect that disagreements will ultimately lead to consensus. But here again, it's important not to let disagreement distract us from a preponderance of consensus. It turns out that the reason more settled science is viewed as relatively settled is that there's a huge amount of consensus about a lot of it. In other words, stable disagreement tends to coexist with a great deal of consensus. And here's the amazing thing, the most important thing. In more settled science, that consensus always includes the parts of scientific theories and models that provide the reliable information we need to act in the world, to make predictions about how things will behave, or to intervene on something to bring about certain effects. Basically, all the parts of science that are relevant to concrete problem solving. Earlier, I cited quantum theory and the Standard Model as examples of more settled science. It's astonishing, I mean, mind-boggling, the success we've had in applying that science to do things in the world, right? From computing to telecommunications to medical imaging, right? The list is enormous. And all of that's because when it comes to more settled science, what's most settled about it tends to be the reliable information it gives about how to intervene in and manipulate aspects of the world. And that's exactly the sort of knowledge that's most important if you actually want to make changes in the world, that is, to make changes that serve the common good. The fact that there are stable disagreements in more settled science goes along with the fact that more settled science is, it's like a machine, a highly reliable, extraordinarily successful machine for generating knowledge that allows us to solve problems. And if we're motivated enough, to make the world a better place. Okay. As I said, I'd like to leave a little bit of time for questions. So let me wrap up here with just a nod to what I regard as some helpful philosophy. I'm a philosopher of science. I'm interested in a lot of things, but most of them are in some way, shape, or form connected to understanding the nature of scientific knowledge. This is a tradition in philosophy that goes back to antiquity, although it wasn't always called the same name. What amounted to the founding movement in the philosophy of science as a self-aware discipline in the early 20th century in Europe was associated with a group of philosophers and scientists called the logical empiricists. Empiricism is the view that if we want to have genuine knowledge of the world, it isn't enough to sit back in our armchairs, right, and think about it. We need to get out into the world to make observations, to interact with it. That's the basis of knowledge. You can see how well this fits with what I noted earlier about science, right? Acquiring empirical information, performing tests and experiments, and so on. Now, empiricism is a long-standing tradition. There are lots of aspects of different versions of it that, you know, I don't subscribe to myself. But one of the core motivations of the logical empiricists was something that I think is especially resonant for us and for humanists generally. Their mission was to establish the sciences as an exemplary, as the exemplary vehicle for producing knowledge of the world, not just for its own sake, but because they took properly scientific knowledge to be a basis for engaging in and bringing about social and moral progress. At the same time, in fact, starting in the late 19th century, another philosophical movement, American pragmatism, also came to the fore. Again, there are aspects of different versions of pragmatism that I'd be happy to take issue with, but there's something at the heart of it that is, again, I think, especially resonant and important for us. The pragmatists thought that concepts like truth and knowledge have to be understood as having a significant pragmatic dimension. What it is for a claim to be meaningful at all has to be understood in part on the basis of what we can do with it, with its practical consequences in human experience. If there's one thing you can take away from this session, I hope it's this. We rely on scientific expertise, that's as it should be. And when we rely on a group of people for something, it's lovely when they agree, but that shouldn't make us afraid of scientific disagreement. I've talked about how disagreement in situations of more unsettled science is actually crucial. It's a good thing because it represents a working through the gears of empirical investigation toward consensus. And even disagreement in more settled science usually sits on top of a vast consensus about the parts of science that we need to act, right, practically and pragmatically to make meaningful change in the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anjan. We have a few questions in the Q&A. The first set, Mark Reimers has two questions. Mark has been doing some work with our Center for Education, making some presentations and classes with us on human brain development, and is a professor and neuroscientist, so has a special interest here. His first question is, please comment on Philip Tetlock's prediction project. He finds that specialists, and most experts are specialists, often do poorly at integrating diverse sources of knowledge and make poor predictions.
Right. Well, I think that the one thing that I wouldn't like people to take away from what I said today is that by relying upon experts, relying on scientists in particular, that we should treat the sciences as though it's a kind of magic bullet, right? That it's a kind of gateway to the truth and it's perfect in its methodologies. There are all kinds of ways in which our methodologies need to be scrutinized because they can be improved. And I think, you know, this particular example of Tetlock might be a very good one, right? Where we need to be able to bring diverse perspectives outside of specialities to bear on thinking about certain kinds of projects. And you know, this is an issue that's taken up by a lot of people in my area, philosophers and sociologists and historians of science, who are really interested in, among other things, how certain kinds of biases sneak into scientific methodologies and how we might illuminate them so as to correct for them. Feminist philosophers of science, for example, have done a lot of excellent work on this. So it's not as though it's perfect or a magic bullet, but it is a system that I think through a process of reflection, we can improve so as to deliver the kinds of knowledge that we want.
Great. Another question comes from Barbara. She says, lack of information about the scientific process leads the people who don't trust scientific information. They can't understand that as we know more information about COVID, the recommendations may change. This change is confusing those who don't trust science. How do you think that problem can be repaired or addressed?
Right. Well, that's a great question. It's a big question. And I think there are a lot of things that could be done, but none of it's easy, right? So some of this really turns on the fact that we have extraordinarily, disappointingly low levels of scientific literacy in society generally, so that the kinds of scientific processes that you're alluding to, right? The idea that science is a process, right? It isn't something where you feed in a quarter and you get out a truth, and that it can take time and that it can be complicated. You know, a lot of misunderstanding of this really stems from people really not having been educated well to understand how science works. And, you know, in part, that's a failure of our educational system. So there's a very big change, right? We're thinking about now curricular change. We teach science in a very narrow way, right? Here are a bunch of equations, here are a bunch of facts. We often don't contextualize it in the way that humanists and others might think about it so as to understand its complexity. That's a big project because it involves educating ourselves, really starting from very early stages in ways that we're not doing right now. On the other hand, you know, there are things that we can do after the fact. So we're stuck with a largely scientifically illiterate society. What do we do? You know, there's really good, I think, empirical research going on now to think about how do we reach people who are inclined to judge things the way that you've suggested, right? Some recent research I was looking at said, you know, just telling people that there's a consensus doesn't really help very much. But if you show them an infographic, right, that might actually help a lot, right? They tend to be swayed more by that kind of evidence. My colleague, Matthew Slater at Bucknell University is doing some research on this. So I think there are things that we have to do both at the foundational stages of education, but also after the fact in society as we have it to try to combat that kind of, well, what I would call, frankly, you know, ignorance about how science works.
Well, thank you. Unfortunately, I think that's all the questions we have time for. That was certainly fascinating and really important to understand what we can and cannot expect in terms of scientific consensus and what that means. Thank you so much.
Thank you.